Hi, philosophy friends. How's it going? Today, we're going to talk about the Sandra Bartke article. And I really like this article. I find it smart and true and a little bit frightening and disturbing also. What Bartke is going to suggest is that the article's called On Psychological Oppression, On Psychological Oppression. So a lot of literature has been written about oppression in general, but normally the kind of oppression that is written about or traditionally is economic oppression, political oppression, social oppression. In other words, establishments, institutions, things in the outside world that oppress, right? And she gives us Webster's definition of oppression: to lie heavy on, to weigh down, to exercise harsh dominion over. So typically we think about ways in which institutions do this to people. But this article is about psychological oppression. In other words, ways in which our own mind, our own psyche, our own psychology oppresses ourselves from the inside. Everything could be fine and dandy on the outside, but I am oppressing myself from the inside. I think this is a cool concept. I think it's a frightening concept. I think it's an accurate concept. I mean, maybe I'm the only one that's crazy. Hopefully you guys will let me know what you think. So Bartke is 100% talking about the psychological oppression that women face. That's just what she's doing. But I would like to suggest for the men out there, or for the mothers of sons, or the women out there that have brothers or friends that are men, I would like all of us to think about ways in which what Bartke is talking about apply to men as well. I don't want to diminish what Bartke is saying. Bartke's message is not meant to be gender neutral. She is specifically addressing the psychological oppression of women. But I think that it's reasonable for us to entertain the extent to which some of these concepts can also be applied, perhaps differently, but to men. So the idea of psychological oppression, generally speaking, before we look specifically at some of the bits of the article, is that because of various things that have happened historically and that are still happening socially in the world, sort of vis-a-vis or regarding women and gender relations, I imagine it as a black smoke, right? I don't know if any of you guys watched the television series Lost, which I really thought was kind of stupid. It was like good for a while, but I don't think they had any idea what they were doing or where they were going and whatever. Anyway, that's another conversation. But this is where I got the black smoke from. For those of you, if any of you watched it, there was this like black smoke that we didn't really know what was or whatever. So the way I first came to think about psychological oppression was a black smoke that sort of like infiltrated, like went in my ears and my eyes and my head and my nose, and it took over my mind. And no longer with psychological oppression, no longer is it necessary for there to be barriers in the external world. Thank you very much. The barriers now exist in my own mind. I stereotype myself. I limit myself. I oppress myself. I box myself in. That's what psychological oppression is. It has a power over us far greater in some senses than external oppression, because this oppression is, it comes from the inside out. I think it's a terrifying, to some extent, concept, but I believe that it's true. For example, I'm sort of rambling right now, but that's okay. when we think about dressing sexy, if a woman dresses in a, I don't know any other way to say it than a sexy way, right? I don't know what this might mean, that she shows off her body in a certain way. There's a sense in which one part of me wants to say, of course a woman can authentically choose to dress in a sexy way, right? She works hard on her body. She exercises. She takes good care of herself. She eats healthfully. She's in good shape. She loves her body, and she's celebrating her body. And in doing so, she's dressing in a sexy way. It seems reasonable that one could authentically choose to do that, right? By authentically choose to do that, I mean do it because she really wants to do it, not because the society has told her to do that, not because men like women who dress in a sexy way, not because this is what the media celebrates, but because she authentically chose it, damn it. She's not being objectified. She's not objectifying herself. She's not sexualizing herself for men. She is doing it authentically for herself. Part of me wants to say that a woman can do that, can choose to do that authentically. But after reading Bartke, whenever, 15 years ago or whenever I first read it, I began to wonder, is that really true? Can a woman choose to present herself as a sexual object authentically? Or has the black smoke sunk in so deep that I now have taken on that stereotype? And I think I'm doing it authentically, but the black smoke has taken over, and really, I finally have just bought in and accepted what the media, mostly controlled by men, has fed me over and over and over and over, almost like brainwashing, right? That's really how I think about this notion of psychological oppression, that women, that the suggestion is that women, to some extent, have become brainwashed. And things that I thought that I've chosen, I've really finally just like been broken down to believe myself. I'm not sure if that makes sense to you, and I'm not sure if you think that that's true. You know, it's similar. It's sort of like the images that we see about what the female body should look like. So this is where maybe it's the same for men, right? What's a man supposed to want? You know, he's supposed to, I don't know. I don't have sons, and I don't have a brother. And I'm not a man, so I know very little about a man's world. But I presume that to be a man, right, you're supposed to know about sports, you're supposed to be strong, you're supposed to be able to fix things, you're supposed to, you know about cars. I don't know, you're supposed to swear or something like that. I don't know, right? And so any man who said, oh, you're not supposed to like to dance, you're not supposed to like certain kinds of movies or certain kinds of drinks, right? These are the stereotypes of men. So any man who does or doesn't fall into these categories could similarly be psychologically oppressed, right? You might think that you really like sports, but maybe you just like sports because society has told you for so long, that's the black smoke, that you're supposed to like sports. I don't know. I don't know. But let's look at the article here and see what specific sense we can make of some of the stuff that Barkey's saying. Let's first just read, this is from the very first page of the article. It's where she sort of explains what psychological oppression is. She says, there are forms of oppression that are not immediately economic or political. It is possible to be oppressed in ways that need involve neither physical deprivation, legal inequality, nor economic exploitation. One can be oppressed psychologically, the psychic alienation of which Fanon speaks. To be psychologically oppressed is to be weighed down in your mind. It is to have harsh dominion exercised over your self-esteem. The psychologically oppressed become their own oppressors. They come to exercise harsh dominion over their own self-esteem. Differently put, psychological oppression can be regarded as the internalization of intimidations of inferiority. The internalization of intimidations of inferiority. So that I'm speaking for all women here, right? I'm speaking for all women here. I have been told so many times what women can and cannot do. That I have taken it on, unknowingly have accepted what has been fed to me over and over and over and over. I don't know if I can find it, I'll post it on our Blackboard site. There's this great Dove, you know, I don't know if you guys know, Dove does some really, I think interesting and thoughtful, media stuff about sort of just commenting about appearance and gender and stuff like that. Anyway, there's a really cool one, I think, where there's a little girl and she looks so innocent, and then flash before her are thousands of images of women and beauty and makeup and plastic surgery and liposuction and breast enlargement, blah, 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 blah. And it's like, we're fed that so many times that suddenly no longer are we choosing any of that. We're just buying into unknowingly what we've been flooded with, and we are now oppressing ourselves. That's the idea to me. Okay, so what does this psychological oppression do? Now, I want to say again that I don't believe Bartke is, nor am I, blaming men or holding anybody responsible for this. I think this is just a suggestion of a way to think about the world. And what do you think? Does it seem right to you? What do you think about it, right? So let's not get defensive here in the event that anybody's getting defensive. But so what is the benefit of this? Well, the benefit of this is theoretically the actual oppressors in the world, they don't have to work so hard anymore, right? If I'm oppressing myself, heck, you can take the day off. I'll go ahead and, you know, mess up my own life, you know, mess up my own sense of identity. You don't have to do that anymore. Thankfully, you've loaded the program now and I've done it myself. You know, it's sort of like, you know, if you teach some, you force someone to do something over and over and over and over again, and then they do it themselves. Okay, I don't have to do it anymore. Like, if I get my kids, I still make my children's bed, which probably isn't the greatest thing in the world. But let's say I stopped making their bed and made them make it every day. Eventually, theoretically, they would sort of wear down and I wouldn't have to make them make it every day. They would do it themselves. Then I could take the, I could be like, oh, I don't have to remind you to make your bed anymore because now you're doing it yourself. So if all of these years, all this effort, unknowing effort, not intentional effort necessarily, but all this effort was exerted by the external world to oppress women, and finally, oh, women are oppressing themselves now. Don't worry about it. Go ahead and take the day off, oppressors of the world. Women can now oppress themselves. Belief that you can't do something because you're a woman. Belief that you should be a certain way or look a certain way. Again, I believe this is conceivably possible, a parallel situation for a man. That's not what Barkey's writing about, but it's not ridiculous to me that there is a parallel thing going on. So she says, this is the bottom of page one, like economic oppression, psychological oppression is institutionalized and systematic, and it serves to make the work of domination easier by breaking the spirit of the dominated and by rendering them incapable of understanding the nature of those agencies responsible for their subjugation. This allows those who benefit from the established order of things to maintain their ascendancy with more appearance of legitimacy and with less recourse to overt acts of violence that they might otherwise require. Right? So if I'm oppressing myself, you're no longer guilty, right? You can be seemingly, magnanimous, and I have the blood on my hands, for I am doing it to my own self. And the crazy thing to me is, how do I know, right? It's that epistemological question. Ding, 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 ding. How do I know? How do I know if I am authentically choosing to dress in a sexy way, or I'm doing it simply because I have been fed this message so many times that it's taken over? How do I know? How do I know? I don't know. How do I know if I want to be thin and strong, and I feel better that way? How do I know if that's true, or how do I know if it's simply because that's the image of women's body I have seen over and over again? I don't know. I don't know how you know if your own notion of your gender identity is a product of your own, my own, our own authentic consideration, or is simply a overtaking of my psyche, of my mind, of my consciousness from the black smoke that has been persistent basically since the dawn of time, and women have been told that they're second, that they're other, that they're lesser, that they're not as smart, that their emotions rule them. When you are fed something, right, this is like, like a kind of psychological torture in a way, right? I mean, imagine, you know, tying someone up in a room and repeatedly showing them images over and over and over again. At some point, we break and we accept those images. Well, we're talking about thousands of years of messages about gender. Have we simply accepted those messages in such a way that we believe them to be true? Varkey also talks about fragmentation and mystification. And I like both of these concepts. Fragmentation is this idea of the splitting of ourselves. I want to be strong, but I want to be sexy. I want to be smart, but sometimes it's cute not to know about things, right? It's this like this splitting of ourself, this desire to be both the one thing and the other thing at the same time. So that's this fragmentation. And then the mystification is kind of like the confusion. I don't know, right? This is where it's difficult to say, if we're really honest about what goes on inside our own psyches. I don't know how much of what goes on inside my own psyche is similar to or different from what goes on inside your own psyche. And I have no idea what goes on inside of a man's psyche. I don't know if a man wonders about his gender in the same way that a woman does. I don't know if a man struggles with his identity, with his presentation of himself, with his appearance, with his body, with his image in the same way that a woman does. And I don't know if anyone does in the same way that I do. I'm just trying to be as real with you guys as I can be. But this fragmentation and mystification, I think, is real. It is the confusion. It is the crazy thoughts that go on in our heads as a result of this clashing of what the media, the world is telling me, and what I feel and what I want, and how to sort of reconcile and balance these various images. She also talks in the article about stereotyping, right? It's fun. If this was a face-to-face class, we could make a list of all of the female stereotypes and all of the male stereotypes. And there's quite a difference in the list. I mean, even some of the articles that are written about gender, we're not going to actually read into them, talk about this notion of the double bind, right? The double bind, that we're damned if we're do and we're damned if we're don't as a woman, right? That if I teach a class and I'm tough and I'm strong and I hold people to a certain level and I don't accept late work, right? I'm a bitch, right? And if I come in to a class and I'm really nice and I'm really easygoing and you can turn the work in ever you want, it's like, oh my God, she's so easy. She's such a typical woman. So it's like, well, what am I supposed to be? I'm damned if I do and I'm damned if I don't. You know, if we think about a man teacher who's really tough, we might say, you know, he's a really tough teacher. He's a really tough teacher. Or if he lets you the hand in the work late, oh, he's really nice. But somehow when a woman does one of those things, this is stereotypically, right, we're in a double bind, or with sexual promiscuity, right? If a man sleeps around a lot or has a lot of sexual partners, he might be described in a different way than a woman who sleeps around a lot and has a lot of sexual partners. If a man waits to have sex until he's married or in a seriously committed relationship, we might admire that in a way where if a woman does it, we might call her a prude. So I don't know if this is still true, right? Again, this is the potential gap between how and when I grew up and how and when you grew up. So this is where you guys need to tell me, Becky, this is so not the way anymore. Or you need to tell me, yeah, Becky, that is still the way, right? I just don't know. I only know my experiences and the experiences of my contemporaries.